decided to identify a series of problems and difficulties and challenges related to the attempt at constructing a language policy for our university.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision.
Oh, yes. Do write a language policy document, please, said our rector, and so we obliged. Because he was very keen on the idea of adopting a language policy so as to better define the role also of our language centre, we drafted the document and submitted, only to be met by the sound of silence. Pursue didactic developments in the wider world, tipo vulco, or circus, and to open the doors to the wider public with an extensive range of services, language courses, individual tuition, teacher training, translation and interpreting, language consultancy, etc. etc. And finally, the centre provides a venue, conferences, lectures, seminars, professional development courses, and so on. So, to the question, do we need a language centre? The brief answer is, yes, of course. Consists essentially of a director or a staff technical linguistico, assisted by a clerk and a pool of disabled employees, and one administrative secretary who we share with the language department. There are also some paid student assistants on a temporary basis. There is, however, no full-time technician anymore to keep the computers working, to install new products, and to assist in technology-led research. So in answer to the question, who does what? Everyone, like a beast of burden, has to muck in. It has to be said that this is certainly an unsatisfactory situation. Oh yes, we can work it out, how to test, what to test. But as the framework policy and the international credit system has simplified student mobility across Europe, a unified testing system for languages fits into this picture perfectly. At the moment, a number of accredited institutions provide examination certificates at all levels of the framework, and I'm talking about Google players, IELTS, British Chamber of Commerce, Alliance Française, Goethe Institute, etc. And these certificates are recognised as valid tests of competence. So the Trieste Language Centre encourages such international justification, and indeed is currently invested in becoming a closed centre for Trinity. But particular interest is aroused in the certification field as a result of Trieste's participation in the iClue project to create online certificates at levels B1 and B2 for English and for Italian as a foreign language. So far, we have produced major tests, and they've been prepared for Italian primary school teachers who now need to have English, and for CLUE candidates. Relations with the institution. We are just another brick in the wall. But it's important that the centre be seen as an integral part of the university's range of services. And to this end, a language policy document has been presented to the major decision makers, the rector and the registrar, in order to bring the centre's resources and facilities to the attention of the university decision makers and the university population at large. We are still awaiting developments. We are still a small brick. Now, oh, reach out. And to these stakeholders, we reach out. The potential users of the Language Centre services are first and foremost, of course, the students and the staff, both teaching and administrative, of the University of Trieste. But secondly, customers reached by our outreach policy. As the most immediate stakeholders, the University Board of Governors need to be made aware of the importance of the former for the success of the internationalisation programme, much flaunted by the Rector, and made aware of the commercial possibilities offered by the latter. And commercial possibilities, as we've been talking about here in Fulcon, cannot be ignored. Outside clients require a different approach, and the Language Centre is aware that a thorough needs analysis is necessary before undertaking any new activity, but such analyses are well within the scope and expertise of the Language Centre staff, who are looking forward to the challenge of diagnosing the requirements of potentially very varied range of clients. Already we have courses for the provincial government in Slovene, because we are on the Slovene border, it's very important, and we offer a series of language courses to the International Physics Centre and so on.
Now on to 5B. Next problem, money. Is always a problem. There's always too little of it, isn't there? However, in our experience, money is not always problem number one. Organization and strategy, or the lack of both, are frequently top of the list. If the university wants its language centre to work effectively for all its proverbial stakeholders, then, besides providing the centre with sufficient funds, it should also make sure that the language centre becomes a distinct and recognisable player in the university's strategic development policies. The bottom line for decision makers is, yes, do give us some money, but don't forget to include us in your strategic plans. We want in. This is probably an obvious segue from the previous track. No university today appears to make do without internationalisation strategies, at least on paper. But what exactly is internationalisation? How does it sit within the very fabric of your particular university? What role do foreign languages play in the university, and which languages does the university really need? For whom does the university need languages? Is it students? Is it visiting researchers and lecturers? Is it your own staff? Providing clear answers to such questions is likely to improve your university the plans, the internationalization plans of your university. And if you know what internationalization really means for you, you can certainly elaborate a more effective language policy. And now, stop. It seems that in times of crisis, language is always the first thing to go. There's not enough money? Well, scrap the foreign language courses. Language researchers, language lecturers, language teaching staff, the administrative staff of language centers have learned this as a sad fact of life. Pity that, even while getting rid of languages, many universities go on emphasizing how important learning a language is for the students' job prospects and how fundamental it is that research is published in English, whether you're in Madrid or in Milan. But the burden is probably on us. Our language policy documents should be more effective in showing why languages are an asset and not a liability. We want respect. Let's earn it. National sensibilities among international staff. You would expect people speaking the same language to establish some sort of fundamental fraternal bond with each other, but then you find yourself in a meeting with your English language tutors, teachers, to help you decide which spelling should be adopted in the university's international web pages written in English. At least two groups will naturally form, maybe Americans on one side, Brits on the other, and they will exchange at least horrified glances every time you mention the relative merits of British and American spelling. Now, never mind that English spelling is a nightmare anyways, but that's another story. So, managing the language center may require a good deal of knowledge of national character so as not to hurt anybody's sensibilities when it comes to issues such as accepted spelling and registered language varieties, teaching styles, and even down to working hours and punctuality. And let's not forget that in academia, clashes between national sensibilities may be nothing compared to disagreements across disciplinary divides. Have you ever tried, for instance, making a generative linguist and a corpus linguist talk politely to each other? And now for the bonus track.
Yes, so far we've taken a fairly light-hearted approach, but I hope that some of the serious elements have come out of this. And we painted it maybe a rather dark and silent picture, but we'd like to end on a more luminous note. So thank you, Vulkov, for providing us with the opportunities for networking and collaboration. And let the sun shine in.
Thank you all for listening.
Thank you very much.